Hi people, welcome to the next episode of MBA Leadership Talk. I'm super, super excited to have Rajan with us. Welcome, Rajan.
Thanks, Jatin. Thanks for having me.
So just a background about Rajan. Rajan works in the venture capitalist industry. He is an investor. He has invested in, mentored, and is on the board of directors of various well-known technology companies such as CarTrade, BillDesk. He's the managing director of Nirvana Ventures, a firm that invests in early stage and market leading companies in the fast growing internet, Indian internet and mobile segments. He's also a partner in March Venture Advisors, which is a over $500 million fund that invests in high potential technology businesses across the world. Prior to this, Rajan was the country head for eBay India. Rajan is an MBA grad from University of Virginia's Darden Graduate School of Business. Welcome, Rajan.
Thanks, Jatin.
So, Rajan, the context is that a lot of people don't have access to you. It was not easy for me as well to have access to you, despite the fact that I graduated from Darden 10 years ago. And a lot of MBA applicants in the country are very naive, Rajan. They don't have the right path. They don't have the right understanding. And anything and everything that you will say will add a lot of value to hundreds or maybe thousands of people across the country, across the world who are applying to top business schools. So really excited to have you here.
Thanks, Jatin. Looking forward to it.
So my first question for you is, you've worked in very high steroid growth-driven environments as opposed to working for, you know, Fortune 500 or general management careers and growing up the ladder there. What suggestions do you have for MBA applicants and current students who want to follow this career path, Rajan, working for venture capital and private equity firms?
Great. So Jatin, let me first start out by clarifying that, you know, many people often use the word venture capital and private equity together. They are actually distinct industries. And I think that sometimes this is not understood by all. So I just like to start out by clarifying some of the key differences between the two categories. So venture capital primarily invests capital in high growth startups, which are generally technology or technology enabled companies that are aiming to create new categories or are displacing existing leaders in existing categories by using disruptive technologies.
Okay.
And so that's the opportunity that they chase. These startups typically have a few kinds of risks that VCs try and manage. You know, the first risk relates to what we call the founder risk, because as a founder, many startups have founders who are first-time founders. So that's something as a VC you need to account for, because you invest very early in the life cycle of a company and you need to ensure that the founder you work with is really the partner you want to work with, but more importantly, the person who's going to deliver the great outcome you want. Then we have what we call product market fit risk. Here, you know, you ask the question, will we succeed in building a product that the market wants at the price point that is viable? So you have founder risk, you have product market fit risk. After you build a product that you think the market will want, it's about how do you take it to market? So you have what we call going to market risk. And here we see, do you have the right product that will find the right distribution channels to reach the customer? So this is about, making sure you find the right path to the customer. And the fourth thing is what we call execution risk, which is, will they be able to successfully scale this startup? Startups often lose money when they start out for many years, but are expected to have a characteristic that we call operating leverage. That is, once they hit scale, they become tremendously profitable. So execution risk is another element of risk before a startup becomes a valuable company.
Okay.
So those are the risks that VCs are expected to manage. And I mentioned that because it'll then go to what VCs will look for when they are looking to hire people. So given that VCs are addressing technology companies and they're making investments in technology companies that are fast growing and they're managing the risks I spoke to you about, what will you need in terms of skills as you're looking to find people to work for a venture capital firm? So the first thing you need is someone who has the ability to network and source transactions. is what we call originating a transaction. And can you do this from the most promising technology founders and get into a transaction earlier than the competition? So if you've been to a technology, a great technology school like IIT Madras or IIT Mumbai, and have graduated, let's say 4 or 5 years ago from there, you likely have a number of former classmates who are doing startups. Okay. So this is a good starting point for differentiated sourcing that allows you to differentiate yourself in terms of the network that you have. The other thing that is interesting is you have the ability to filter and benchmark ideas to win a deal. Yeah, after you win a deal. So, you know, you need to be able to understand complex ideas and which are very abstract, and have the ability to diligence them. And therefore a technology degree is often helpful.
Okay.
You know, the third thing you need is you need the ability to work with founders. So you need to have interpersonal skills and the credibility for a founder to take your point of view and make you a partner in their progress. And then other than this, obviously, as you become senior in a firm, you need to be able to hire key team members in your portfolio companies. You need to be able to have a network where you can introduce the company to key strategic relationships. And you have to have a network to help the companies raise follow-on funding. So coming out of all of this, the natural fit for a venture capital firm will typically be someone who has a technology degree or will have built a startup or have been the part of a founding team of a startup.
Okay.
And they will have worked, this is one path. Or another path is that they worked in the corporate development for a large technology company. And because intellectual curiosity matters and the ability to understand problems across, you know, many industries matters, new entrants from VCs tend to come from a consulting background because they problem solve there.
Okay.
So technology plus consulting makes for a great starting point to enter venture capital. Private equity is a little different. Okay. Private equity firms typically invest later in the life cycle of a company. So unlike a venture capitalist, you know, who had the four risks I spoke about that they're managing, the risks that private equity manages are called execution risks and financing risk.
Okay.
So the rate of growth of a typical private equity company may oftentimes be much lower than a venture capital company. These companies will mostly be profitable and they won't have what we call venture risk. And the key factors to success in this industry tend to be that, you know, you need someone who's very deal focused and has a strong finance orientation.
Okay.
So these are people who may have started out their careers in investment banking and have a business or finance background typically.
Okay.
So venture capital and private equity is actually quite distinct, although they sort of have some common areas.
And Rajan, where can people see themselves heading in, let's say, 10 year long horizon, right, working for either venture capitalist or a private equity firm?
So, you know, if I was to talk about venture capital as regards career pathing in VC, different firms have different philosophies. You know, it's quite common for an analyst in a VC firm to spend about 2 years in the firm and then to leave and join a promising startup. And they do this either as a member of the founding team, sometimes they do their own startup. This is important because many firms believe that, listen, to make partner at a VC firm, you need to have had enough operating experience. And you're only going to get that operating experience by going and working in either a startup that is scaling rapidly or founding a startup and understanding the travails of entrepreneurship, because that's when you can counsel other founders who will be willing to listen to you because you've been through a similar journey. So one of the, you know, challenges of career pathing early in your career in venture is that it's highly unlikely you'll get back into the corporate world. So one of the things an MBA should think about is it's always an option to come into venture capital at a later stage in life. But if you start out in venture capital, it's highly unlikely you're going to go back into corporate land. You've got to be ready to be in startup land. And so please don't take a role in venture capital or, you know, chase down a role in venture capital because it seems glamorous or it seems like a hot job. But do it because you're committed to the startup lifestyle. It's great for learning, but makes career pathing really hard. That's in venture capital. If you're going to private equity, you know, oftentimes private equity, you know, a lot of people target to get into private equity straight out of school. You know, ideally, you're probably just as well off going and working for a top tier investment bank and then looking to laterally move into a private equity shop after 4 or 5 years. Okay. Because if you can work for a top tier investment bank and then go work for private equity, you got the best of what we call both the sell side and the buy side. And the path 10 years from then typically should be, it should land you towards close to partnership in a PE firm.
Okay. If people have two different options, Rajan, domestic MBA versus international MBA.
Yeah.
Right. And a lot of people, so there are two paths. One is you're a fresh grad, undergrad, and you go to IIM Ahmedabad, Bangalore right after college.
Right.
The other one is what you chose. You worked and then picked an international school, international MBA. How do you think from the perspective of venture capitalist industry, how are these two looked at differently? Or how do you think is the exposure different?
So that's interesting. I think, you know, I'll take a broader view of this and I'll say that if you see the majority of your career being in India and you can get into a top tier business school, then that should be your first preference. If on the other hand, you see yourself as someone who's going to work overseas mostly, then a global MBA from a top business school like Darden, Harvard would be very helpful.
Okay.
You know, the top Indian business schools today are almost on par across most dimensions with schools, you know, the top schools in the US and Europe and in Asia as well. But the single biggest advantage of a global MBA is the global exposure and access to resources that are available at top global business schools. And that's why sort of if you want to work internationally, the number one advantage of going to a global business school is placements. If you're going to place out of a Indian business school, it'll largely be Indian companies or MNCs with a presence in India who will be recruiting. In the US or other markets, you'll have lots more global opportunities. The second is the visa status. You know, if you're placing out of a US or European business school, you get to work for some years, then there's a path to creating a more international role for yourself. The third is brand recognition. And I'd say that brand recognition within India of the top tier business schools is fantastic and it compares with the best in the world. But brand recognition, if you want to work for a global firm, it helps to have a global MBA just because that's recognized globally. So I'd say, you know, these are the main reasons. Placements, visa status, and brand recognition would be the primary reasons to consider sort of outside of India. But the overriding thing is, you know, where do you want to spend most of your career? And if it's going to be in India, then my strong advice would be that if you can get in a top tier Indian school, it's well worth it. If you have the ability and the means to go and do a global MBA, it's an amazing experience. But I've got to be honest, from a career perspective, the real reason to go there is if you want to create a global career for yourself.
Okay. So you talked about careers in the venture capitalist industry. Now, I want to also ask you, so you've invested in companies, BillDesk, you know, Cartrade, and let's say a fresh MBA grad from Darden or ISB or IIM Ahmedabad has an option to either pick Bain, BCG, McKinsey, or says that I'm starting my career with one of these organizations when they're in an amazing growth stage and there are a lot of opportunities coming up. How do you think the career path or the learning curve would look different for these people, Rajan?
Yeah, no, I think this is a great question. You know, the learning path in consulting and the learning path in a high growth firm are both very steep and they're excellent trajectories for lifelong learners. I think though the key difference is when you go down the path of consulting, it does help you understand scale much earlier in your journey. When you're in a high growth company, you're along for the ride and you learn scale as you move along.
Okay.
And what I mean by that is, you know, if you join, you know, McKinsey, Bain, BCG, chances are you'll likely get to work with some very large companies dealing with problems at scale.
Okay.
These are companies that will largely be companies that are incumbents who are being challenged by disruptors. The exciting part is being in one of those companies that are disrupting and, you know, 10, 15 years from today are going to be amongst the largest companies in the world. If you look at what's happened over the last 20 years, the pace of change has been amazing. In 1995, a company called Amazon did not exist. A company called Alibaba did not exist. A company called Google did not exist. Facebook did not exist. Tencent did not exist. Now, if you look at these five companies, which are among the top 10 companies in the world, they didn't exist 25 years ago, and today constitute $4 trillion of market value. So there's, you know, tremendous growth, tremendous learning happening because of the explosion of innovation riding on the back of the internet, riding on the back of mobility, and now on the back of artificial intelligence and cloud technologies. So there's massive change happening. It's transformative, and there's amazing opportunity to learn and be involved in that change versus observing that change and trying to impact it. So, you know, without sort of having a preference for either consulting or high growth, you have, if you're more of a thinker, you want to spend time in consulting. If you're more of a doer and like to solve big problems, you probably want to be in a high growth startup.
Wow. So one is, I think based on what I know from talking to the MBA community, Rajan, once again, in the middle of the interview, thank you so much for doing this.
Yeah, sure.
I know some people want to be entrepreneurs. I've seen the essays, you know, we see these essays all the time that I want to be an entrepreneur right after I graduate from a top B school. And coming from the, you know, the top VC of the country, Rajan, no, you please tell us, what do you think are the milestones or the checklist that people should have before they think of entrepreneurship as a career?
You know, I think the best entrepreneurs are almost by definition instinctual. They have an instinct of what they want to do and they want to get in there. So, you know, I would not attempt to create a set of goals or milestones for them. You know, as a mentor of mine once told me, for an entrepreneur, you have to leap and the net will appear. So you don't plan.
Okay.
But, you know, that said, if I could offer some advice, the only, you know, two data points I'd ask every entrepreneur to think about. One is, what is the problem that she is seeking to solve? You know, what is the solution that she has to solve that problem? And why is she so uniquely positioned to solve it? So that's question number one related to the problem. And then, you know, the second thing, which often I find entrepreneurs don't spend as much time on, is spend time understanding the structure of the market that you're attempting to solve the problem for, and specifically distribution in that market. Because oftentimes you have people making great product, but have not thought enough about distribution, how they'll make money. And that's where an idea fails. So if you're a passionate founder and you're looking to do a startup, you know, absolutely allow that passion to drive you. But if there are two questions you ask yourself or two areas that you want to spend time thinking about, it's on product, what problem you're solving and why it's unique and how you solve it. And second is on distribution market structure. Is it such that can be altered or changed around your product proposition?
Okay. I have a very interesting question for you. An essay question. I know you wrote essays.
How can we escape that with an MBA interview?
I know you wrote your essays a long time ago. And there's an essay. Stanford has an essay that says, what matters most to you and why? And different schools have variants of asking for why. you know, and people respond to this essay when they are, they're 23, 24, they're 3 years out of undergrad, 4 years out of undergrad. And you coming from there, looking at from where these people are, you climbed a lot of mountains, Rajan. You've gone far, far, far ahead. What is, if you had to answer that, what matters most to you and why? Now, Rajan, what comes to you, your mind?
You know, I'm a big believer in destiny. I also believe that we can shape destiny by our actions. You know, I've been very fortunate and I'm very thankful to be where I am. But what gives me most joy and a sense of purpose today is if I can have a positive impact on someone's life. So that's really what matters to me at this stage of my life.
Thank you so much. I can really sense it, Rajan. I can feel it because I know you've been very particular about saying that you really... So I know I've seen your enthusiasm for this interview. And it was easier to set up an interview with you than I had imagined, you know? Because I think you were very forthcoming to say, all right, let's get on it. And I know this. Rajan, that was my last question. I'm sorry, you were saying something.
No, I said thanks a lot, Jatin. It's been fantastic. And thank you for hosting me on this event.
Rajan, it's my pleasure. Thank you. Thank you so much for coming. And a lot of people, I'm sure, in the years to come, will refer to this while writing their short-term, long-term goals. Thank you.
Thanks so much.
Thank you.